dungeon here. Goedemiddag.
Hoi hoi, hello and welcome to the Meet Maastricht podcast. I'm Katrina and together with our resident local Lucy, we will be exploring some of the amazing stories that make Maastricht so special. So sit back, relax and join us as we learn about our favourite Dutch city. Hello everyone and welcome to episode 21 of the Meet Maastricht podcast. I'm Katrina, here with Lucy as always. It feels like we've been away for a couple of weeks since we last recorded, just the two of us. How are you, Lucy?
Well, it's kind of cozy to be back, the two of us, isn't it? I mean, it was...
Yeah.
we had a great time being in a spacious room with the three of us to be COVID safe, you know, you, Katrina and me. But we're back to our old method again. That's Katrina in her home and me in mine.
And what are we going to talk about today, Lucy?
Well, as I announced, I'm intending to talk a bit about what we call in Maastricht het Spaans gouvernement, and Spaans is Spanish, mm-hmm. and government is of course what the Second World signifies, but that it doesn't really cover the function and the use of the building very much. So you know, that is what we will be talking about, because it has this cute name, but and of course there is a totally comprehensible way in which it got that name, but it's not something you think of right away, and it's got very little to do with Spain also.
Oh, okay. So it's not the home of the Spanish government in Maastricht then?
No.
Okay.
It served as a accommodation for the Spanish kings at times. But that, you know, that is part of the story. The building we're talking about is on the Vrijthof. Mm-hmm. And anybody who lives in Maastricht, even if you have not been there for very long, you've been on the Vrijthof and you have seen at Spaans gouvernement. When you are standing with your back to the churches, on your right-hand side, there is a two-story building which is painted in a vivid red color, and that is at Spaans gouvernement.
Yeah, so for anyone wondering, the Vrijthof is the square with the Sint-Servaas Basilica, so big church right next to a big red tower.
Yeah.
So easy to spot. And right next to it is the museum on the Vrijthof, which is the building we're talking about.
Yeah. Yeah. Here I am simply assuming people will know where the Vrijthof is, because it's that big place that is now pretty much taken over by the cafes, and it has the two big churches.
Yeah, and there's a big bike path right through the middle.
Yeah. Yeah.
At the moment.
Yeah. Now, which feels a bit funny, because most of us have a habit of cycling across there anyway, and now they've gone and painted a bike path over the middle of it, and you have to stay right on it. So there's these white painted angels on the tarmac saying this is your lane and stay in it. And
yeah.
Oh gosh, yeah.
So the museum building, when was that built?
Well, that's a lengthy, convoluted story. of course, as if it ever could not be in the history of an old city. You know, it's just not possible. It is. It has two characteristics which make it very special, even in the rather special collection of buildings that makes up Maastricht. It is a civic building. It always was. So it has never had any religious function. And it is the only surviving example of a Renaissance building in Maastricht. So as far as style, building style period is concerned, it is one of its kind now in the city. And of course that also makes it extra interesting. It started as a house that was the property of, unavoidably, the church creeps in anyway, of a canon of the Sint-Servaas, And the first mention of that house is from the 14th century. And for several more centuries, really, most of that house was half timber, although I don't think it has ever been thatched. So it probably had slate roofs from the beginning. But it consisted of three parts of not really separate buildings, they belong together, but built in different periods and built to different heights. And more or less the floor level in stone and the levels above that half timbered. And it was in that way that it was donated to be used by the city government. And that was for a very donated as in you can use this, because the actual ownership remained in the hands of Sylvas, the canons of Sylvas, until the French Revolution. But it has always, after the original donation, it has always been used for public and private civic functions.
Oh, okay. So after people stopped living there, what was it used for?
Well, it was used really as a hotel only.
Hmm.
For visiting royalty, to put it in contemporary terms.
Okay.
And I did explain before, and of course that's a recurring theme in our talks as well, that Maastricht for hundreds and hundreds of years had dual lords.
Yeah.
And one of them the Duke of Brabant, the other the Bishop of Luik, Liège. And the Duke of Brabant was a title that, because of dynastic marriages and conquests and inheritance and, you know, whatever worked, sort of grew into a world encompassing empire. So the Duke of Brabant became the King of Spain, and the Duke of Burgundy, and the Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, and because of being the King of Spain, also becoming the ruler of all the discoveries, so-called discoveries in the so-called New World. So something enormous. And really the first person who embodied this was the Duke of Brabant named Charles V. And he could be considered a boy from the block, really, to put it very irreverently. He grew up at the court in Brussels, and he probably spoke something very akin to what the people here spoke.
Oh.
It's quite feasible that they would have been able to just, you know, talk to each other and understand.
Yeah.
And it was in his lifetime, due to the accumulation of all these rights and territories, that his empire became one in which the sun never set, as the saying goes. So, which means having bits all over the world.
Yeah. So, did he stay in that building in Maastricht?
Yeah, twice.
Okay, so I was going to say more of a holiday house.
Yeah. No, but you see contemporary royalty doing this sort of thing as well. I mean, I think Queen Elizabeth is quite a homebody, but at the same time she's got how many homes, and Christmas is at Sandringham or something, you know, and
yeah
that. And of course these proprietors, rulers of vast estates, countries, territories, would have several of these places all over everywhere. But the function of many of those houses would, you know, become largely symbolic over time. You know, they'd make a tour of the empire to inspect everything. So Charles V came here with his sister in 1520, I think, and then you know, the middle of the 16th century, and then 20 years later he came back with his son Philip II, and this is the Philip who the Low Countries rose up in revolt against and liberated themselves.
Oh, okay.
And then I got confused with the inscriptions on the embarrassing this, so I will just tell you about it. I got confused with the inscriptions on the gable because I thought that the Philip that is mentioned there was this Philip II, the son right. of Charles V, but the one, the Philip being referred to is his father, Philip the Beautiful, who was a Duke of, yeah, he was called that, I can't help it. Or Philip the Beau, if that is sounds less disconcerting, but, and he was one of these grand Dukes of Burgundy.
Yeah.
Which then, of course, was also in the inheritance of his son. So.
Ah. Well, it doesn't help that all their names are the same, does it?
No. When I had to take exams on these dynasties, when I was being taught history, it was still heavily. On the, you know, the dynasties and the battles and all that. So we had to know all these people and when they were born and whom they married and how many children they had and what their names were and when they died. So I just drew these enormous, what would you call them, genealogies of...
Family trees, I guess.
That's the word, thank you, yes. Family trees. To try and tell them apart. You know, and of course it is very necessary to be able to tell apart Charlemagne, who was a Karel, as we would say, or Charel in dialect from the 9th century, and this Charel, who is from the 16th. Big difference. Also not the same family. So he's been here twice. He's stayed in that space twice, and it was a comfortable little palace kept at the disposal of the king emperor whenever he deigned to visit his loyal subjects.
Yeah. So you said his son was the one that people really rose up against. Were there any? Changes, I guess, in attitudes or opinions towards the building at that time? Did it change function or?
Yeah, it did, but I haven't come across any, because you know the weird thing is we still call it the Spanish government,
yeah.
Because Philip was primarily the king of Spain, because after Charles V died, the empire was split up and the Habsburgs territories went to a different branch of the family. So his son Philip basically only retained the authority over the Low Countries and Spain, and of course Spain's colonial empire. And then the nobility of the Low Countries thought he was too heavy-handed, if not to say dictatorial. And also this is linked up with the Reformation. So Protestantism in its different versions and shapes going through Europe, and it is quite feasible that a lot of this Low Country nobility took on Protestantism as a way of resisting the deeply, devoutly, ridiculously Catholic Philip. But it definitely inspired the working classes, so to speak, of Low Countries to rise up in revolt against the Spanish overlords as well, which resulted in our Revolutionary War, which took 80 years to conclude.
And is that the point where Maastricht was definitely a part of the Netherlands and not somewhere else? Is that point?
No, because then we're talking about the middle of the 17th century, and Maastricht's place into the contemporary Kingdom of the Netherlands has only been cemented in territorially speaking in 1839.
Oh, okay, much later.
Yes, with the Peace Treaty of London. Then they finally, then the uprising of the southern Low Countries, now Belgium, against the rest of the Low Countries, now the Netherlands, had to be pacified.
Different uprising.
A very different one, yes.
Okay.
Yes, the 80 Years' War is in the 16th and 17th century.
I don't need a family tree. I need a big timeline of everything.
Yeah, you need a timeline. Yes.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, Charles V is 16th century, and his son, of course, also becomes the king in the 16th century. And it is this son in the 16th century that the Low Countries rise up against. And then when that revolutionary war was over, the revolutionaries were looking for a king and couldn't find one, and that is how the Low Countries, the northern part, became a republic. That was not the original intention. That was sort of by, you know, because they couldn't find a substitute crowned head, and then. And of course the merchants and the shipbuilders and all that, you know, we can rule ourselves, bugger it, and that's what they did. And then these parts, and that includes Maastricht, they were under a military governorship for a long time, so basically a colony.
Okay, right.
Yeah, and that's it. And that situation didn't really resolve itself until definitely and totally until the end of the 19th century. So the people of Maastricht, have really not been citizens of the country, well, not even for 200 years, a lot less, actually.
Yeah. So what happened with the building?
Yeah.
Was the revolution, the French Revolution, sort of turning point, like a lot of the other buildings we've...
Yeah, no, but if you remember the buildings that we saw being ransacked or torn down or, you know, changing hands and then becoming dilapidated,
yeah.
those were all religious, remember?
Yeah.
You know, the French revolutionaries abolishing the church, so to speak, so, you know, who cared about the churches and the convents and the canons' houses and stuff like that. But this house, although technically still a canon's house, no, they didn't harm it. It was used and it was sold, and yeah, the people would just continue on. And it's sort of interesting. You know, this building has been standing there for about 500 years, and it's sort of interesting what they've been doing to it in that time.
Yeah,
and it's adding windows and. Bricking up arches, because, you know, if you walk in the let's start at the oldest idea here. The building originally had a courtyard, and so there was an open space behind the building, and to enjoy that open space, even if the weather was not too clement, whether too hot or too wet or whatever. The bottom part of the building was colonnaded on the garden side, so to speak.
Oh.
So that is this facade dates from the 16th century and is pure Renaissance, and it is still there. That is to say, it has been restored carefully in the 1970s sometime, because, you know, it had also been bricked up. And you know, people do the most terrible things to buildings, and the windows have been enlarged and all that sort of stuff. But you can still walk into the museum, because the first thing you come across there is really the spaces of a cafe.
Yeah.
So you can just walk in, and it's possible the people from the ticket office will sort of go, excuse me, but, you know, if you will explain that you just come to have a look at the facade, they will let you. So you walk into the former courtyard, which is now covered, but in very obvious 21st century style, so you will be aware of the fact that you are in a former courtyard. You simply turn around, and then you're looking at the garden side facade of the Spaans Gouvernement, and that is it's a beautiful, beautiful Renaissance facade.
Yeah, and we should also say that you can go into this building if you buy a ticket. You can go and have a look around, and it's a really interesting building. There are big rooms and little rooms. There are big, very obviously new parts,
uh-huh.
and very sort of tiny staircases. It's really interesting to have a look around, and really tells the story of the process and the progress that the building has made over time.
Absolutely. And it's and I thought I'd start you off easy with the Renaissance and then go on progressively. But it's, and you know, one more thing I would like to point out about this Renaissance facade in the courtyard, so on the inside, so to speak, is that there you can see very clearly that the building material on the higher levels was marl, you know, this soft, easily pulverized sandstone from all around here. And you can see there are reddish pigments on there. It is not evenly painted red as the outside facade is on the Vrijthof. I mean the building is very red. I mean that's the easiest way to find it. That is modern paint, but the custom is extremely old, because. Yeah, what this is reddish dye is an iron oxide, which is found with marl. When you go and mine the soft yellowish stone, you can find this stuff as well, and it is more ochre yellow, and then people used to burn it and then it would become a red color, and they would paint the marl facades with that, because it would chalk in the marl would then connect with the iron oxide in such a way that the stone would be better protected.
Oh wow, how interesting.
This is also why the Tower of St. John's is red.
Oh, so it's the same sort of stuff.
Right. Yeah, and there are more houses like that in Maastricht who still retain traces of or simply have red marl walls. So people would do that to prolong the lives of the stone.
Yeah. Okay. And how long has the front been red? Is that more of a modern thing?
It has been red for a long time, and then after that it was painted white, and the decorations around the windows were grey. But since the last restorations in the 2010s, it has been red.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and we had to get used to that, and we had to get used to windows being taken out, and the architect and that was saying, this is how it originally was. But this is always a problem, of course, in restoration. What does that mean, original? I am looking at a page here with drawings of both the facade on the Vrijthof and a page with the facade on the courtyard, and you know, you can just see that over the span of 500 years, all sorts of things have been happening. You know, entire parts of the building have been replaced by another building, and then a piece was demolished and replaced by another one, and there were windows added and subtracted, and you know, and so on and so forth. But what is still original, that has barely been touched, except for the hearthstone crosses that subdivide the windows, is the range of windows on the first floor on the street side. And then this is, of course, in public. This is on the Vrijthof. So if you're on the Vrijthof, just toodle over and have a look at the windows on the first floor, and then the three to the right-hand side, because they have, in a sort of alcove over the windows, they have the, how would you call that, the heraldic signs, the emblems. You can just read from the imagery and from the accompanying text, you can just read his political manifesto. Go and solve that puzzle yourselves.
Yeah, when it's a bit cooler, go and explore.
Yeah, go and have a look at the three windows, and if you can't make any sense of it, get back to us, and then we'll explain.
So what other functions has it served in its lifetime then? You said it was a sort of hotel at one point.
No. Hotel. Excuse me. Hotel only for the visiting royalty. Huh? Yeah. So it was a guest house that was kept in available for if the king passed there, and that meant, like I said, that happened twice.
Oh, well, what was it being used for? I mean, did people live there in the meantime?
Yeah, that's of course what generally would happen. They would.
I was going to say, it seems like a bit of a waste.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, and then more recently, in the 20th century, the municipality used it for receptions and gatherings. But then the house, this is something that started in the 20th century, thanks to a wealthy couple from The Hague. And this is a really, really weird story. A wealthy couple, and his name was Frey Wagner, and her name was Broos Wagner de Wit. Of course, Frey and Broos are not the usual names, but of course, Frey was called Frederik Hendrik Angela Alexander, you know, so obviously you would shorten that to Frey. And his wife had something similar, and then Adrienne Ambrosina, so yeah, and they shortened that to Broos. And this was a couple, a very wealthy couple, who lived in the Hague, who inherited quite a bit of wealth and beautiful stuff from their different branches of the family, who became collectors in their own right of art of the 19th and 20th century, and then also traveled extensively all over Europe and bought souvenirs left, right, and center, but then not of the cheap variety, you know, the medieval boards and things like that. So, and then this is the really, really weird turn in this story. Then they bequeathed the lot to Maastricht, where they've never lived, because they thought it was such a pretty city.
Oh, well, that's nice. Just thought it could do some art.
Yeah, it could. No, but the rest of the story is really depressing. Oh. Because, you know, they put this in a donation to the city of Maastricht, and they stipulated that the museum had to be arranged to house the collection. And they were not demanding it had to be a public museum at all times, but they wanted it decently housed, and they wanted the building to be used, and they also wanted the building to be open to the public at times. Well, this took decades and decades and decades until the municipality of Maastricht then, you know, arranged for het Spaanschoolement to house this collection. So that was the 20th century use of the building. It was presented and it was used as an imitation or a recreation of the living environment of very wealthy upper class people. So then they took great pains to recreate a wood paneled room, which is an absolute jewel. And of course, in the curating and collecting that went on in the decades after the donation, people have taken great care to fill some gaps and to create cohesion and to, you know, describe objects and, you know, to properly curate it. And this was presented in its Spaanschoolement as, like I said, as a pleasant house. And once in a while, the public could enter as well. I can remember times when in the run-up to Christmas, the doors would be opened, and then in the large dining room with all the appropriate furniture and furnishings, the tables would be set with the finest china and crystal and with lavish flower decorations, and you know, so we could all come and see how the other people lived. And it's but for some reason, this has all gone to pot, and I am not exactly clear on why that happened or how. But the vast majority of these objects and of the arts are, as far as I'm aware now, and if anyone knows better, let me know, are now in storage. So they can't, they can't be seen anywhere. And the museum was, the building was overhauled yet again to become a museum of, how would you say that?
It's a museum of photography now.
There was something there before that. After the Mock lived in house.
Okay.
They established a museum there that presented several branches of industry, manufacture, production. In Maastricht that were. That have been really important, and one of them was a printer.
And that
is not something you would think of right away, but a publisher, someone who printed books and also printed books that were forbidden elsewhere. So Maastricht, like Antwerp, like Amsterdam, has played a role in the history of what we would now call free speech.
Yeah, well, there's a little museum. I can't remember the name, but it's just down from the Ding House, and they have all kinds of printing stuff, right? Like printing equipment.
Yeah, that's a Drukkunst museum. So yeah. the typography museum.
Okay, so a little bit different.
Yes, what I am talking about is a publishing house.
Okay, so like big printers and stuff.
Yeah, or just revolutionary books and pamphlets.
Okay.
That sort of thing as well, and also the silversmiths. Like Liège, Maastricht for quite some time had a great tradition in superior silver work, not necessarily jewelry. Quite often it would be weaponry, but tableware and stuff like that, and also carpentry and things like that. And it was, and I thought it was a shame that all the art had disappeared from the museum when they shifted to this new program. But this new program has also only lasted for a very short time, and then the museum closed, and now it has recently, last year, reopened as the Photography Museum.
Ah, so it hasn't been open very long as the Photography Museum.
No.
Because I came here in January 2019, so I've only really ever seen it as the Photography Museum. But I assume there were sort of objects and artifacts as part of the displays?
Yeah.
And I know we've talked about this before, but Maastricht doesn't really have a museum of Maastricht.
Yeah, it's weird.
Where I feel like those kinds of things feel like they would go.
Yeah, exactly. And it's when this redecoration took place, from the Wagner De Witt decoration of course there was a lot of discussion about this in the city, because there were also lots of people saying, oh well, good, we've got all this stuffy, dusty, boring Wagner De Witt stuff out of the way. But I'm thinking, yeah, come on. I mean, there was, even if you don't want to look at furniture and tableware, there was still the art collection of the 19th and 20th century, and from local and regional artists to quite an extent as well, and it comes up in every conversation about topics like these. Why does Maastricht not have a city museum? Well, because there's a very simple answer to that, because too large a proportion of the Maastricht populace, including too large a proportion of its politicians, just couldn't care less. There has never been enough pressure from enough people with enough influence to arrange this, and it's mind-boggling. It really is. You can only look.
It's so funny because, can't speak to what it's like in Europe or anywhere else, but I know in Australia, every little tiny town you go to, even just with a population of 1,000 people or whatever, there will be a little museum of that town run by a couple of very dedicated retirees. I know, if just driving through every little town you go to, there's always one building, a really old building, that is the museum of that town. Yeah, so as a newcomer to Maastricht, when you're Googling, or if you're like me and are interested in heritage and are Googling, you know, what museums and things to go to, that there isn't a museum of Maastricht.
Yeah, and there's the formerly municipal one, which is now the state one, so a national one, the Bonnefante Museum, and there, everything they have related to the history of Maastricht is also in storage.
Yeah, because that tends to be more sort of contemporary art.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. And there's gorgeous paintings there from the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. That doesn't pertain to this region at all. Most of it is German and Italian. It does have an absolutely mind-boggling collection of wooden sculptures. Many of those are from the region. But quite a few of that quality and by those sculptors are also still around in the churches in Maastricht. So that was one of the reasons that people have been saying, well, we don't need a city museum because you can see this stuff everywhere. And it's simply not true.
Yeah, the city is a museum.
Yeah, and you can go into the treasure rooms of the churches, and there's loads of stuff there. And you go and see archaeological digs in the Hotel d'Erlon, and you can take a walk. And then, and of course, now with the digital possibilities, there is of course the wonderful extra layer of accessibility that the digital media offer. But still, you know, I and many other people still do not feel that's an adequate substitute for a solid city museum.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess it would be interesting, seeing as that the building has had so many evolutions already, what it becomes in the future. And there are some really interesting exhibitions on as well, so make sure you go check them out. And if you're not super into photography, there's still the building itself is really interesting. And there, I guess, I don't know if they come from the initial collection, but there are some huge, big, gold-plated, gilded mirrors that are really beautiful as well.
Yeah, but that is part of an 18th century Regence. Interior that was salvaged from a grand mansion on the Tongense Street. So that house was demolished, but they saved the paneling, and then paneling was added to it from other houses to complete it. And they haven't dared to destroy that, but so that is still in place. But, you know, don't get me wrong, I absolutely do not object to het Spaanse Gouvernement being a photography museum. I mean, I am griping about so much of Maastricht's history and heritage being put away in cellars and attics, so to speak, and, you know, not on full view.
Well, hopefully, one day, we can start a museum, Lucy.
Yes.
We can find all the treasures.
Just first find the billionaire.
Yeah, well, if there's any billionaires listening, we have a pitch for you. I have to ask, as always, is there anything else you wanted to add?
Yeah, you have to ask. And I always say no, because I think after about half an hour, I just suppose our listeners are quite sick of it. So no, I think this is enough. And for the next pod, I am returning to the common people, so to speak. We'll be talking about St. Matthew's Church.
Ah, okay. Is that the one in Wick?
No, the. Yeah, the Matthijs is on the Bos Street.
Oh, what one am I thinking of?
So that is where the weavers used to live, and later the factory workers of Sphinx.
Oh, I think I'm thinking of St. Martin's.
Yeah, you are, but you need to be on the other side of the river.
Well, I'll be educated next week and find out all about another church, just what I need. Thank you so much for joining us today, and don't forget to follow us on social media. You can find us on Facebook by searching Meet Maastricht, and on Instagram @meet_Maastricht. If you would like to learn more about us, you can also visit our website at meetmaastricht.eu, where you can buy tickets and subscribe to our monthly newsletter, so you're always up to date. Thanks again, and tune in next time to learn more about our beautiful city.
Tot ziens.